Welcome back. So, let's say we have a system with proper signal flow and AEC reference. We can use a simple process to get the best performance from the AEC processing. Step one is all about gain structure. Calibrate each microphone input to -20 dBFS nominal. This applies to all microphones, regardless of whether they come in on analog inputs or via other transports such as Dante or AES67. With analog mic inputs, simply use the analog preamp gain control to achieve this. In external microphone systems, you'll most likely want to log into that system and calibrate the microphones to send the appropriate nominal level. Remember that all system inputs should be calibrated to the same -20 dBFS nominal. This includes program feeds and signals from the far end. Now that the conferencing mics have proper gain structure, we'll next want to check the signal-to-noise ratio of each microphone. It's fairly easy, as we'll simply want to be quiet for a few moments and let the mic sense only the noise floor of the room. The only other consideration is that we want to do this while any air conditioning, projector fans, or other noise sources in the room are running. If the noise floor of the room, as sensed by the microphone, is below -35 dBFS, it meets the SNR requirements for a conferencing system. If not, external methods of noise control are recommended to get the required 15 decibels of signal to noise at each microphone. We might think we simply need to turn on the noise reduction in the algorithm, but it will most likely not function well in a poor environment. Once the microphones are set to nominal level and we know the signal to noise meets the standard, we should be able to leave them at a unity gain throughout the signal chain. The next step is to calibrate the near end side of the system. For this step, we'll want to first turn the amplifiers all the way down. If there are no amplifier controls, reduce the max RMS setting of the QSYS output block all the way down to -40 dBU. Now, start playing a program source and calibrate it to nominal level of -20 dBFS at the QSYS input block. Leave this program source playing with unity gain through the entire signal path to the output. Using an SPL meter, bring the amplifier controls or max RMS setting up until the SPL reaches a comfortable listening level. The standard for conferencing systems is 70 to 75 dB SPL. Finally, we're ready to make a test call. You'll want to have a trusted person on the other end who can give you qualified feedback about the level and audio quality at the far end. Adjust your caller's far end audio source to reach the -20 dBFS nominal level. With unity gain through the signal chain, you should have the same 70 to 75 dB SPL in the room you measured with the program source. If the far end caller tells you there's noise at the far end, enable the noise reduction and level. Keep in mind that the noise reduction algorithm is designed to remove constant, steady-state noise, not things such as the noise of passing traffic, talkers in the hallway, etc. Engage the noise reduction with the NR enable button and apply only the amount of noise reduction needed to eliminate the noise. Applying too much noise reduction could adversely affect the quality of the mic signal at the far end. If noise reduction is required, you'll want to make sure it's applied to all the microphones in the room. Now, we'd like to check the performance of the AEC algorithm when only the far end is talking. Looking at each conferencing mic, we'll want to confirm that the RMLR meter is showing green, as in this diagram. The target is zero, meaning we want the reference signal level to match the level of resulting signal at the microphone. In most rooms, this will require that some attenuation is applied to the reference signal, which can be done in the AEC block itself. As previously stated, it's a good idea to mute any conferencing mic signals in the DSP after the AEC processing block. That would be the first choice, but sometimes the AV designer doesn't have that choice. The microphone audio could come from a Dante-enabled microphone, for example, without a way to get a mute signal back to QSYS. The mic mute button would then most likely completely mute the Dante audio feed to QSYS from that mic. QSYS has at least one option to accommodate this scenario. The hold if mic level below setting holds the AEC convergence when the mic audio level goes below the setting shown. If this is set to be just a few decibels below the noise floor of the mic when unmuted, the algorithm will hold there through the mute state and have less work to do when it's unmuted again. Starting in QSYS version 8.1, there's also a setting to hold the AEC convergence if the reference level goes below a certain level. This is useful if the far end signal must be muted before it hits the AEC reference block. If there's still some residual echo to your far end test caller, then it's time to engage residual echo suppression, or RES. First, use the button to enable the feature, then engage only enough to remove the residual echo. After that, it's time to test the system in the double talk condition. Have far end and local talkers speaking at once and see if echo reaches the far end. If so, increase the RES percentage to just enough to eliminate any echo. You'll want to be sparing with this, as conference participants may start to feel like the system is half duplex as it's increased. As an aside here, note that one mic in a room might be harder to calibrate than others due to placement, etc. As a first pass, it might make sense to apply the same settings to each mic, but if the test caller hears echo, it may get more complicated. You'll want to isolate exactly which mics in the room are returning the echo and mute those that aren't problematic. From there, you can fine-tune each problem microphone independently of the others until you have the performance perfectly dialed in. Of course, many rooms are required to use multiple methods of conferencing. Sometimes they must be used simultaneously. If this is your room, first do a test call with each conferencing mode independently, and then finally all methods at once, making all the necessary adjustments. So, what if you've tried the steps as outlined and still have echo? Let's think about a few troubleshooting strategies. One common problem is that the echo heard by the far end isn't echo at all. A quick way to check this is to mute all the conferencing mics and see if the far end still hears themselves. If so, the conferencing receive signals are accidentally looped or misrouted. If there are any large matrix mixers in your design, carefully examine the cross points to make sure that the far end receive signals aren't accidentally being sent directly back to the transmits. This routing can be tricky when multiple conferencing modes are required, so keep that in mind. If an external video codec is being used, the codec itself can be a source of such a loop. Many codecs have a reinforcement mode, or reinforcement output, that includes the conferencing mic signals and the far end. The intent of such a thing is to plug directly into an amplifier for voice lift and conferencing in the room. If this type of codec output is plugged into QSYS as a conferencing input, you can hear some very interesting echo-like effects. In addition, the microphones will be sent to their own AEC reference signals. This usually results in some modulated sounds of the mics to the far end. The QSYS hover monitor is an easy way to check for this. Hover over the input node, and if you hear the local microphones, you know this is a potential problem. Other sources can cause similar issues, so an easy way to find the culprit is systematically muting each source and microphone until you find the one that muting makes the echo go away, and you then know exactly where to focus your problem-solving skills. If you know all routings and gain structure are correct, and you've done everything you can to calibrate AEC with no success, it's possible you need to extend the tail length of the AEC algorithm. The tail length required should depend on the size, shape, and reflectivity of the room. If you're using the 100 millisecond tail length, it's very possible you'll need to extend to 200 milliseconds. The 200 millisecond algorithm can handle about 85% of conference rooms, but if the room is very large and very reflective, it might require 300 or 400 millisecond tail lengths. Remember, the longer the tail length, the fewer algorithms can fit in a given core. The eternal struggle here is that architects and end users love elaborate room shapes made of very reflective surfaces. Glass, hardwoods, and ceramic tile are not the greatest environment for conferencing, but it's what we get to work with as AV engineers and technicians. In some cases, it's necessary to propose acoustic treatment be used to absorb some reflections to provide the best in intelligibility and response. Something like this should do the trick. In all seriousness, there are many tasteful, low-profile acoustic treatments available that can help maximize performance. That's it, and thanks for watching.